good friend of Launchpad's. He's been speaking at Launchpad for a very, very long time. He said that he will now try to set up a schedule where he speaks to Launchpad about a slightly different topic each time, once a quarter. So this is our holiday version of Gary O'Neill. He is a technical recruiter, and his topic for today is never apply now. Don't apply now. Gary O'Neill.
Hello everyone, good morning. So I'm gonna need your help today. So it's gonna be a little bit more of a town hall conversation than it is a presentation. So I'm gonna need you guys' help. So make sure that you're ready to kind of participate if you don't mind. So I'm curious, how many of you ever applied for a job and never heard anything back? All right. So my topic today is called Don't Apply Now. And what we're going to talk about is imagine a world in which there was no corporate job boards. Imagine a world in which there was no Indeed. Imagine a world in which there was no Monster. And imagine a world in which there were no jobs posted anywhere on LinkedIn or anything else. What would you do? Right? What would you do? And so what I'm here to tell you is that what you would do in that situation is what I would encourage you to do right now. And I'm going to kind of explain to you why, because I'm absolutely serious about don't apply now. It says, don't apply now. Wait, really? Yeah, really. Let me explain to you kind of why. Because you've applied for jobs and never heard anything back, right?
Right.
So what I'm going to do is, I've been running recruiting teams for a long time. I'm an entrepreneur. I've started multiple companies. I've been first or second person to about 15,000 hires, probably more than that at this point in time. So there's not much about how hiring works that I haven't seen. So let's talk a little bit about what happens with applying for jobs. Let's talk about applying for jobs by the numbers. Who in here could help me with some math and statistics and probability? All right, I got at least one volunteer here, so if somebody else wants to run it too, then we'll figure out what the medians are in this. Here's the deal. So what I'm going to talk about is I'm going to talk about my particular team. I run recruiting for Austin HR. We have about 200 clients in the Austin area. And work on a lot of different jobs and a lot of different companies helping them make hires. Most of the jobs we work on, we don't post at all. And the reason why we don't post them is, mostly it was a waste of our time. Most of the people who apply are qualified. And if it were really that easy, most of our clients wouldn't pay us that much money. But I did go look at the statistics related to people applying for jobs. So here's a few statistics for you that you can help me with, right? So we have, over the course of the past 2 years, let's just make the numbers easy. 1 in 20 jobs that we've ever placed anyone in was through any response to a job post. So you start with 95% of all jobs that we fill have nothing to do with any response from job posts. The other thing, and what we're going to do is try to come up with the probability, the statistics of how many people, what's your likelihood of getting hired that way. And I'm not here to discourage you from applying for jobs. I'm here to say, all right, so if you spend 15, 30 minutes a day looking online and applying for jobs, I want to know what you do with your other 8.5 hours that you're working on finding a job. So I'm going to help you with all the rest of the time that you got. So what I found is that with respect to the different ways we post jobs, on average we get 87 applications for the jobs that we post. So you could even make it easy. Let's just say 75. Let's be generous. So it's about 87 of those. About 1 out of 20 jobs we filled that way. So the simple math, if you want to figure that out, is to say, what's the chance that 87 people are applying for each job on average that we even post? All right, let's just start with the ones that we post. 1 in 20 actually get filled that way. What's the probability that somebody actually gets the job?
Not that much. 1,750.
Yeah, 1 in 1,750. So it's less than a tenth of a percent, right? Somewhere the way that works. And so let's take another type of organization. So the way that my organization works is that we're a third-party recruiting firm. Austin HR does a lot more than that. But people pay me and my team to help them hire great people. And so we don't do a whole lot of job posting. We use LinkedIn and other resources and reach out to people. But let's take the other extreme. Yes, sir?
So if you say
one in 20 that you actually fill as a response to a post, how many of those 20 jobs would actually be posted somewhere?
All I'm looking at is, of the ones that we do post somewhere, those are the statistics. So just to keep it simple, of the jobs we post, one in 20 get filled that way. Yeah. So let's look at an organization where pretty much their only strategy is posting jobs and hiring people out of that set of people. So what I know in those organizations is still about a third of the roles that they ever post never get filled, because they either close the role or hire a referral or what have you. So in the ones that I know that rely primarily on hiring off the job post, I would say that probably, let's just be generous, say 70% of their hires come from those job posts, right? And if they ran the same numbers that we do, which is somewhere in the neighborhood of 87 people per job apply for those kinds of things, even in that set, what's statistically your chance of getting hired when you apply for a job?
It's less than 1%.
Yeah, it's still less than 1%. And that's the reason why if you apply for lots of jobs, you don't always hear something back, right? Is this making sense? I just want you to understand kind of how the numbers on this stuff work. So let's talk for, so the probability is actually reasonably low. And let's talk about why, all right? Let's talk about why that is. By the way, another set of statistics that I know of, is anybody familiar with rate management? Mm-hmm. Yeah, so they're an outplacement firm. The numbers that I saw not too long ago that were from rate management, they did a big survey of the people who were some of their constituents, the people who they work with. I think they found somewhere in the neighborhood about 14% of people found their jobs through applying for them, and that was after they had gone through a training program. And that's a fairly common number that I see. And we also see common numbers that say only about 15 to 20% of all jobs are ever posted anywhere. So all of this is meant to say, while I would always encourage you to look at job boards and find jobs, I want to open up some other possibilities for you because you're only addressing a fraction of the market. So let's talk a little bit about why, just so you understand, why is it that response to job posts is so low? Anybody got any ideas? Why is it that it turns out to be so low?
Well, just given some of the laws, companies have to post jobs, even though they already know who they're going to hire.
There is no question that some percentage of them, they already know who they're going to hire. It's going to be somebody promoted from within. They're compelled to post the job. And so there are some percentage of them that really aren't real. So there's one reason why. What's another reason why?
It's your numbers. Now look at all the number of people you'd have to respond back saying, sorry, no thanks.
Yeah.
You'd have no time to interview the rookie.
Yeah, sheer numbers. So even in our case, where we get an average of 87, right? I mean, the time that it takes to go through that 87 is a significant amount of time, right? Why else?
They tend to look at referrals first.
Probably tend to look at referrals first, and not only tend to look at referrals first, but what I can tell you about recruiters is that a lot of the real recruiters who are reaching out to the marketplace, we have an affinity for the people who we went and found, as opposed to the people who are applying for jobs, because somehow there's more affinity because you found them. So there is some preferential treatment to people coming in through other channels. No question. Why else?
Yes, sir. Specific demographics that they're looking for that would be awkward if they advertise it, and have to turn certain people away.
Certainly, yeah. So there are actually some laws called OSCCP and things of that nature that have to do with where you're posting your jobs and whether or not you're actually, as an example, if you intentionally post to certain places that only attract a certain demographic, you can actually get yourself into a little trouble. Yeah, what else?
Physical connections make an impression versus static job board connections.
Yeah. No question. So people that people know, networking and things of that nature, what else? There are a million of them.
Well, one of my pet peeves back when was job descriptions that are written for unicorns. People that don't exist.
Right. Yeah. Yeah, as a matter of fact, just on that note, always take job descriptions with a grain of salt, and here's the reason why. So the way that most job descriptions come into existence and jobs to get posted out there is that a hiring manager has a need. They're really busy doing all kinds of other things. They go to HR or whoever it's going to post the job, and somebody says, well, here's what we posted last time. The hiring manager looks at this one and kind of goes, yeah, okay, cool, and they post that. And so there isn't always a lot of connection between what's posted in the job post and what the real job is going to be. Other reasons are, did you have one back there?
Actually, can you repeat the question?
So the question really was, what are all the reasons why applying for jobs it seems to be so ineffective? I mean, it's a very inefficient game. And again, I'm not here to encourage you to, although I said don't apply now, I want to show you some other things to do in addition to, because if your only job search strategy is applying for open jobs, chances are very slim. We found out probably less than 1%, which is the reason why it takes applying to hundreds for it to work out into a job. Yes, sir.
So I was speaking to some colleagues who are job recruiters, tell me that the companies they work with usually have a committee, and they all have very specific requirements, and it's almost impossible to find the person to match all those requirements. So it's really the recruiter's job to make sure that their customer, which may be multiple individuals at a company, get a piece of what they're looking for.
Yeah, as a matter of fact, what you're talking about sometimes is the jobs. So what he's talking about is that sometimes the requirements are so specific that, again, it's kind of back to that unicorn. They're looking for something that's really rare. And so once they post it out there, the likelihood of somebody applying for it that's going to fit all their criteria really low. In fact, we're going to address that specific issue here in just a minute.
Because hiring tends to be viewed as not a core competency, as an extraneous, difficult, unpleasant task that you have to do on top of everything else. My manager's being by a grumpy.
Absolutely, right. Absolutely. Did y'all hear that? So basically it's just an unsavory task, so people avoid it, right? They avoid doing that.
Maybe the most important.
Yeah, maybe.
Haven't done HR before. I think that perhaps it's because your resume might be ineffective.
Yeah.
So that makes applying.
Certainly. She was saying that your resume might be ineffective, which is part of the reason why response rates from job ads are particularly low. One of the most important things to do in that regard is that sometimes people want to make their resume a little bit more generic to open up lots of possibilities. What I can tell you is the more you become all things to all people, the more you become nothing to anyone. So to the degree that you're not really clear on who it is and what you do, what problems you solve, the less interesting it is. So we could go on and on. Let me just give you a couple of other ones. So a firm like mine, when we post jobs, sometimes we're in competition with other firms, so that's on occasion the exact same job is out there five different times, right? So there's another reason why it's not going to happen. Some of the companies that we work with will work on things where I'd say probably at least 25 or 30% of the time the job actually vaporizes and goes away before it's ever filled. So there's so many reasons why. So what I want you to know is that, again, my message here today really isn't about don't apply for a job. It's really about what to do in addition to that, right? So, and I just wanted you to kind of understand from behind the scenes part of the reason why it's so ineffective. If we posted 10 jobs, you get 870 people applying for those jobs. The ability to even look at, much less go through that set. And then what happens is that since when you apply for jobs, you don't get a response, then oftentimes I hear people say, well, I just apply for lots of different things. I mean, it can't hurt, right? Well, the answer is it can hurt, because on the receiving end, 95% of the people who apply for most of the jobs aren't even remotely qualified for it, which means that recruiters and companies have trained everyone else to respond to anything that moves. And on the reverse end of it, by applying for things that you aren't qualified, you've trained us to not look in the pile, right? So it's this weird dynamic that goes on, and it's just a really inefficient marketplace.
So it sounds like you might be different than some of the corporations that you actually just look at them rather than letting software clean the pile up before it gets to you.
Yeah, interesting. So thanks for bringing that up. The other thing that does happen, and this is one of the things I talked about last time I was here, is that a lot of corporations, any corporation that's 50 or more employees, almost all of them that I work with have an applicant tracking system. So when you apply for a job online, you're going into an applicant tracking system. What a lot of them will do is it'll check the job description and parse the words in that and take your resume and parse the word in that and try to match them and sort them by keyword matches. And sometimes they're only looking at the ones that have the highest keyword match. Now, intellectually, what you all know is just because keywords match on the resume against the job description doesn't mean that that's the best fit for the job, but it is a way that when you have a recruiting team that's overwhelmed with response, it's one way for them to try to limit the set down to something that's doable. So it is really important when you are applying online for a job, that's really, you're really competitive for, it is worth taking the time to look at the words that are in the job description and change your resume enough to match up. And the larger the company, the more important that is, because the larger the company, the more likely they're using to use technology to slice and dice it. We don't, just because I'm not a big believer in that, but that's because I'm there, not because it's not commonly done. All right, we all good? This stuff making any sense? All right, let's talk about what they did. So now what? So I have a couple of things to suggest in terms of now what, but before I suggest it, I'm curious, if we all agreed and we all said that applying for jobs online is important and keep doing it, but it's really not all that effective, what else can we do? Now what? Now what do we do? Or go back to my original statement, pretend none of them even exist. What do we do? Now what?
Networking.
Networking. Tell me more.
Reach out to people that you know in the industry. Attend events that are industry specific and reach out to people that do what you want to do. You might not know them, so you can get connected to them.
No question. Tell me a little bit more about that. How do you identify them?
A lot of times I'll look for who's got that role and then see if I have somebody in common with them and see if I can get them to do an introduction. I do LinkedIn searches.
Yeah. LinkedIn is your friend. In fact, the flip side of it is that the majority of jobs that my team is involved in, the majority of roles where we're looking for people, the majority of jobs that we fill is by using LinkedIn, identifying target individuals, reaching out to them, and getting them engaged. So the truth is, for when you're looking for an opportunity, flip it around the other way, and you go identify people, right? It's really the way the game is played. What else? What else can we do? Yes, sir.
I've taken a little different approach. It is networking, but I found that if I reach out to people before I meet them for help on a job, that they're a lot more receptive when I do reach out to them.
There you go.
And so I do that by making sure that I contact 5 or 10. I've got a huge network.
Yeah.
Close to 2,000 people.
Yeah.
But I reach out to 5 or 10 a day.
Yeah.
That have an anniversary, a birthday, and just say something. I ask them for their updated contact info. Talk about their kids if I know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
And I just make sure that I'm touching 5 or 10 people a day. Then when I look at them, I go look at who they work for. If that company is interesting to me, I put it in my list of companies, and I look at the careers.
Yeah.
If there's nothing there, no boss, no file.
Right.
If there is something there, I might say, hey, do you know anything about this?
Got it.
And then later, as the year goes by, I've touched pretty much everybody. I've got their contact updated. I've got a great list of companies that I want to go to work for.
Mm-hmm.
Every week, I also look at my list of companies to see if anything new has popped there. And then I have someone to go for an informational interview.
Right. Got it.
So that's
could y'all hear him pretty much?
Okay.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. All right. I'll summarize that. What else?
Meetups.
Mm-hmm. Meetups. Right? Okay. All kinds of ways of doing, all kinds of doing network. What it really comes down to is that, you know, as a recruiter, I spend the majority of my time reaching out to people and trying to contact them. And if I was on the other end of the spectrum, which is looking for opportunities, that's exactly what it is that I would do. Now, another thing that you can do, and this is a really simple little step, which is we recently posted a job, which we rarely do, but we recently posted one. And some of the people, you know, we got 40 or 50 applications in the first couple of days. And just yesterday, one of the people who had applied for the job bothered to call me. They called into our main line, they bothered to call me, they reached out to me and specifically said, hey, I saw that you had this particular job that was posted online. You know, I sent over my application, just wanted to make sure that you got there and see what I could do to, you know, essentially help you out. All of a sudden, they went from one in a whole pile to the person who I was actually on the phone talking with. It wasn't a job that I was working on personally, so what I did was I direct connected her with the recruiters on my team who was working at it, and that person, by doing nothing more than bothering to make a phone call, moved themselves to the front of the line. Right? Really simple thing to do. Over and over and over again, what I can tell you is that when we do have jobs that are posted, and whenever somebody actually bothers to reach out, particularly through phone, they almost always get moved to the front of the line. Now, I can't always guarantee that's going to happen, but I can guarantee you that it's a really good move to make. So when you see a job that's posted for XYZ Corporation, you believe that you're really competitive for that particular role, it's not all that hard to identify the people to reach out to. You can use LinkedIn, go into an advanced search, search for the title recruiter, and see if you can't go find the recruiter, and see if you can't go find the hiring manager. You can look up the company's main phone number. You can call that main phone number. You can usually get to a director of extensions, and usually you can get to the voicemail or the phone of both the hiring manager and or the recruiter who's working on it. So I would really, really encourage you that when you're applying for a job online, reach out directly to those people and get yourself moved to the front of the line. Because otherwise what happens is you're one of the 100 that's in a pile. I'm busy doing all kinds of things, and chances are I don't even see that you applied for the job. Move yourself to the front of the line that way. Does that make sense? That's a simple one to do.
Where was it that you were saying the hiring manager name comes from?
LinkedIn too, because normally what happens is, let's say it was a Linux administrator position, right? Let's just say. So if it was a Linux administrator position, then you would go into LinkedIn, you put it in title search that says like IT or IT manager or director, what have you, the company name, because you can put, not the search at the top, go to an advanced search, you can put in the title and the company name, put in the name of the company, put in different titles the hiring manager is likely to have. You may come up with more than one. If you didn't hit the particular hiring manager, one, anybody who might be a hiring manager, reach out to all of them. But if you hit somebody who isn't the hiring manager, if they're at that right level, they probably know who is and can sometimes get you connected up.
Do you find people are fairly receptive? You hit the wrong hiring manager and you're asking for information about somebody else that's coming?
You know, chances are they're not going to connect you up, but sometimes it will, which is part of the reason why I reach out to multiple ones of them. Sorry. We doing all right? Does this make any sense? My whole point is to try to say that while searching for jobs online and applying for jobs online is important, there are a few things you can do to really help yourself out. One is that, you know, really, honestly, you know, if you're not competitive at all for the job, kind of you're not going to get hired for it. But the other one is, if you are competitive for the role, go identify the recruiter, go identify the likely hiring managers and reach out to them. You can reach out to them via LinkedIn. You can use some tools to find their email address, but the most powerful tool you have to find them is this one right here. Because all of a sudden, an email message, you're not human to me, you're just an email message. When you reach out to me and pick up the phone and you call somebody, you just became significantly more human than you were before. And there's enough dehumanizing about the recruiting and hiring process. The phone is your friend, right? So don't be afraid of the phone. Yes?
These days, a number of LinkedIn posted jobs have the job poster. It has the actual name of the company.
Uh-huh. Yeah.
If that person is not the HR within the company or the hiring manager, they are, say, third party recruiting company, is it better to go off and search for someone actually within the company, or is it still a good idea to reach out to them?
So her question was, if you see a job that's posted by a third party, are you wanting to connect up with that third party person like me? Or whether or not you want to go directly to the recruiter and the rest. My answer to that would be, I mean, what I would like you to do is, one, as a third party, I'd love for you to connect with me. Give me a day or two. If you hadn't heard from me, then go direct, right? Because if I'm not good enough at my job that I can re-engage with you within a day or so, then I'm probably not going to be of service to you. So once it's clear that I'm not going to be of service to you, go direct at that point in time. So, but, you know, going direct isn't all that harmful anyway. Right. So, but as the third party, I'd certainly love to say, hey, well, if you recognize the opportunity because of my efforts, at least give me the return, sir. Give me 2 days to get back to you. If I haven't gotten back to you in 2 days, then go direct is all good. All right. So let's do this. I want to talk for just a second about, and this kind of gets back to somebody's point earlier. I said that I was going to talk about that. Points or whatever. But let's work backward from this job post. Let's work backward from it in time and see what's happened, because I think there's a, it's kind of almost a John's point about reaching out to people ahead of time, but let's work backwards from it. So if there's a job that was posted out there, right, why was the job posted? Why was it posted in general? I mean, there's all the exception cases called, well, they had to and they're compelled and all that kind of stuff, but what's the general reason why the job was posted? Because the company has a need. They have some problem that they want to solve, right? All right. Now, prior to the job being posted, what was going on? prior to the job being posted, in general, what was going on?
Internal search.
Yeah, there was an internal search. They're trying to figure it out themselves. They're hoping somebody in their network, and lots of times, they're sitting there hoping that serendipity was going to happen and somebody great was going to show up on their front porch. Now, when they have this internal search that's going on, what happened before the internal search? What happened before that?
There were problems or issues.
Yeah, there were problems or issues before there was even approval to make a hire, right?
Exactly.
I was going to say, what are the types of problems that occur? One of them is somebody left, right? What's another type of problem that a company has? Sometimes they have growth. They really knew they had new needs. They're growing. They don't have enough people to do the work. What's another?
Reorganization.
What kind of problem does that cause?
When they reorg and they get people in different areas and they identify they have gaps.
Sure. So there's gaps. So again, it's another version of they have a need to hire somebody. What else happens?
Larger shifts. The shifts in the workload from one department to another.
Yep. Shifts and workload. Can't move people around. They need time and knowledge. Sometimes it's because somebody's going to be let go. Right? Sometimes there's all kinds of different reasons why. But if we go through that entire list, including somebody quit, right? How many of you have been hiring managers before, managed teams of people, right? How many times, honestly, when somebody quit, how many times was it a total shock to you? What percentage of the time was a total shock versus when you saw it coming?
Very little.
Very little shock, right? You saw it coming. You saw it coming, right? Now, during that period of time that you saw it coming, if somebody who was motivated, qualified, and all the rest had reached out to you, what would you have done? Would you have engaged with them?
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, there you go. All right. What about the circumstance where your team is growing, or you've sold some things, or there's a reorg or something that's coming? My point is, we could go through all of these, and what I guarantee you is that most hiring managers know months in advance of when the job is going to be open, that it's going to be open. They haven't gotten approval for it yet. And so, you know, how many of you as hiring managers in this room previously had somebody weeks or even months prior to you having approval to fill the job, but you knew that it was coming? How many of you would have engaged with somebody who had reached out to you? How many of you? Raise your hands high so everybody can see. Yeah, most of you would have engaged with someone, right? So here's the story. Hiring managers generally know months or at least many weeks in advance of there even being approval to hire someone. They know weeks or months in advance that someone's about to quit. And a lot of times, somebody who's about to quit is also the same person who's about to get fired, and you're just waiting out, hoping that they quit before you have to fire them, right? I mean, it often happens that way. And so what happens before a job gets posted is time has gone by. The hiring manager's running out of runway, right? Because maybe there's a project or a need, whatever the problem or the burning need is, gets greater over time. By the time they post the job with the unicorn level requirements, because they no longer have the learning curve or any time to do anything other than hire somebody who is an absolute perfect fit for the job. So between the time a hiring manager recognizes that there's a high probability that a hire is going to happen, and before the job is ever posted, time goes by and their ability to hire the right human being who isn't a perfect fit for the job goes down. Right? Does this make sense?
Yeah.
You with me?
Yeah.
All right. So, if you work backwards from all this stuff, you just kind of say, well, why was the job posted? Why was it open? Why was the hiring manager? You get all the way back to a point in time where a hiring manager is kind of going, hey, there's a good chance I need to hire somebody, but they're not working on it yet. Chances are they don't know anybody yet. And if you, as a motivated human being, reach out to those people, then there's a really good chance that they will not only engage with you, but you get to the front of the line before there ever even is a line, and you get to them in a time where they still have the opportunity to hire the right person who isn't a quote-unquote perfect fit for the job. That's how this game is played, right? So if you want to play above the rim, you get way ahead of the jobs being posted. By the way, if you believe me that hiring managers generally know several months in advance that a hire is going to happen, what's today's date? Yeah, December. So what percentage of all hiring managers for all hires that are going to happen in Austin, Texas in the month of February, what percentage do you guess already know that they're probably going to hire somebody in February? Yeah, 80% probably at least. So what you have is 80% of the hiring managers for the jobs that are going to get hired in February, and some even in March, already know, but they don't have approval and they're not working on it. And certainly isn't posted. Now's the time to reach out to those people. Okay? Now's the time to reach out to those people. And what I hear people often say is, I don't know whether there's a job open. So back to your point, John, he was saying you follow up with people because of anniversaries and all kinds of other reasons. And you said you go to their career site and see whether they have something that's open. My point is that the stuff that they're really going to hire for is not on their website. And, you know, all you're doing is limiting, because you have no idea whether they're hiring or whether they're not.
It's usually not hiring managers. They're usually individual contributors, or they might be a manager in a different position from somebody I've worked with before.
Sure.
So that would be an informational interview,
yeah,
or somebody who will find me the hiring manager or introduce me to the recruiter.
Yeah. My point really where I was trying to go with that is that if now you identify companies and say, yeah, they don't have a job that's on their careers page, I'm telling you that for hires that they're making in February and stuff, they're not on their careers page yet. I promise you, they're not there yet. Okay?
I will find the hiring manager. From now on, I will add finding the hiring managers, or if they're a hiring manager, ask them about any future needs to my strategy.
Absolutely. Absolutely. All right. So for me, here's my suggestions as to what you really do to not just apply for a job or not just press apply now, which is really consider what problems do you solve, right? What problems do you solve? So the problem you might solve is you help busy executives stay organized and stay on top of their schedule so that they can have more productive days. Maybe the problem that you solve is that you decrease days receivable by being really good on the accounts receivable side of things. Maybe you do medical billing and coding to ensure the customer or patient satisfaction and increase time for insurance companies to pay. Maybe the problem that so consider what problem it is that you really solve and get really clear about what problems you solve, right? Because the only thing that businesses care about and hiring managers care about, what I care about even as a recruiter, is what problems do you solve? And the idea of, well, I can solve all kinds of problems. I'm a jack of all trades. I'm a box of tools. Just tell me what you want to do. Yeah, thanks. Next, right? I'm not really interested in that. I want you to be clear about what problems you solve. Now, that's not to say that you can't solve more than one class of problem, but what my point is, identify the problems or the sets of problems that you solve. Once you do that, who has those problems, right? Who has those problems? So, you know, what's a good way to identify the kinds of people who have the kinds of problems that you solve? Tell me some ways. Because, and here's what I'm searching for. The majority of companies that exist, you've never heard of, right? The majority of companies are small and medium-sized businesses that you've never heard of. And you have no idea whether or not they have the kinds of problems that you solve. When you're driving down the road and you see a sign on a building, do they have the kinds of problems you solve? I don't know. So how can you identify whether different companies have the kinds of problems that you solve? Yes?
There was a presentation before that talked about one strategy was going to LinkedIn, looking for keywords, matching, let's say your, do scheduling, I don't know.
Yeah.
And then typing that in the keywords and seeing companies here. So a LinkedIn, a very detailed LinkedIn search.
Yeah, very detailed LinkedIn search, you say. And specifically what I'd suggest is go be a recruiter. Go find the people who solve the same kinds of problems that you do. Wherever they work, by definition, must have the kinds of problems that you solve. Right? Go find people who are like you, who solve the problems that you solve. And by definition, those companies must have the kinds of problems that you solve. Now, what people come and tell me is, well, I don't know whether they're hiring. Yeah, I don't either. I have no idea whether or not they're hiring. But what we know is that at any given time, some set of those hiring managers. So what you can do is identify the people who solve the problems that you solve. You now know where it is that they work. You can now use LinkedIn to try to identify who the likely hiring managers are. And what you now know is that those hiring managers hire the people who solve the same kinds of problems that you do. So you can easily begin to reach out to those hiring managers. Now, do they have a job that's open? I don't know. And you don't know either. But some percentage of them already know that they're going to be hiring people in January and February and March. Some of them actually do have jobs open that aren't posted. You just have no idea. But my point is that once you can identify the other people who've solved the same kinds of problems you do, now you've got a list of companies, go find the hiring managers and reach out to them. Does that make sense?
So when you say reach out, is it just, hey, I'd like to link out, link in with you, or is, hey, by the way, I do this, this, and this, or?
Yeah, so great question. So the question is, you know, what do you do to actually reach out? And so let's talk specifically about contacting them, right? So there's a couple of different ways to contact people. One is the easiest way to identify them these days is through LinkedIn as a way to identify the people you're going to reach out to. You can reach out to the hiring managers. You can reach out to those people who actually solve the same problem as you do, which are the peers. You can certainly reach out to HR and recruiters as well who are inside of those companies. You can certainly send them a connection request in LinkedIn, which is an easy thing to do. Or the other thing you can do is there are a lot of tools that exist for you to find people's email addresses. Couple of them that I can share with you that are really good. One is called Email Hunter. They actually just changed their name to Hunter. You can get a free account. They'll let you run like 150 searches, 200 a month or something like that. I have a paid account and I get a couple of thousand of them that way. And what it can do is if you add Email Hunter to your Chrome as an extension, it actually in the LinkedIn profile, it actually adds a little orange button where you can click on it and it brings you back what your likely email address is. It's either verified or what they do is for most companies, there's a pattern for what email addresses are. So if they find other patterns, they'll suggest what the pattern happens to be. By the way, has anybody heard of Reportive? Do you know what Reportive is? So Reportive, R-A-P-P-O-R-T-I-V-E, Reportive. It's also a plug-in into Chrome. And what it does is, if you use Gmail, and you have an email, if you're creating an email message and you put in an email address, and you hover over it, if that's actually somebody's real email address, they have a LinkedIn profile, it'll light up with their picture and their ass over here, so you kind of know whether or not you have a good email address. I mean, I use it all the time. Email Hunter, yeah, and they actually just rebranded themselves as just Hunter. I think it's hunter.co, but you can search for Email Hunter and they'll find it. There's another one that's called Prophet, P-R-O-P-H-E-T, Prophet, which is also a plug-in into Chrome. And when you're on somebody's LinkedIn profile, you can pull it out over there and tell you what their email addresses are and the rest. If you connect with them in LinkedIn, then once they've accepted your connection request, there will be a little button under their picture that says contact information, and generally, you have their phone number and their email address. And oh, by the way, since you're reaching out to three or four people at these companies that hire the kinds of people that you hire that solve the problem you do, once you found out that Sally Jones's email address is sjones at Acme Corporation, what is Dana Carvey's email address? dcarvey at, right? By the way, if you're an IT manager and you want to kind of keep people from being like me, from basically reaching in and finding all your people, don't use email address patterns like that. It makes it really beautiful for people who do what I do. Really beautiful. So it's pretty easy. Identify them on LinkedIn. You can find their email address. But one of the things I shared with you earlier is that this thing actually is your friend. Honestly, the easiest way to reach them is this way. Because every company has got a phone number. And when you call their phone number, what usually happens? You get an auto attendant, and the auto attendant says, for a directory of extensions, please press 8, is the most common one. And now you can go straight to your voicemail, or straight to the phone.
The three plugins you mentioned, Email Hunter, Retraction.
Email Hunter is one of them. The other one is a company, one called Prophet, P-R-O-P-H-E-T. Both of those help you identify email addresses, yeah. Email Hunter and Prophet. And the other one is Reportive, R-A-P-P-O-R-T-I-V-E. And what Reportive does is it adds a section over to the right in Gmail so that when you hover over an email address, if that email address actually is in their LinkedIn profile, it will light up over here on the right-hand side with their picture and all that kind of stuff. So as an example, if I didn't know what your email address was and you worked at Acme Corporation and I try a bunch of different patterns, when I hover over the right one, it lights up. Okay, got it. Now I know your real email address is.
Cool.
Yeah, so I got your email address. So you can email them, you can connect with them in LinkedIn, you can send a message through LinkedIn, you can send an email message from LinkedIn, you can pick up the phone, you can call them. So you've got all kinds of ways of reaching out to these people, right? All kinds of ways of reaching out to them. And I mean, there's so many different things that you could say. I mean, so many different things, right? But my suggestion is, regardless of how you say it, the thing that matters most is that you say something. Reach out and say something. I would probably not suggest that you reach out the, hey, I'm looking for a job, do you have one for me? That's probably not the best strategy. It's probably a little bit more along the lines of, you picked them because you identified what problems you solve, or what problems you solve. And then you identify places that have those kinds of problems because you found people who do what you do or what you want to do. And then you identified the hiring managers and the recruiters and you reached out to them. You probably ought to reach out to them and tell them what kind of problem that you solve. So here's an example. My name is Gary O'Neill. I'm a certified Microsoft administrator and IT security specialist. I help companies get the most out of their computing investments. I'm networking to see if you know anyone who may be interested in talking with me about how I can solve Windows network and IT security issues. There's a gentleman here who had his, he was reading his elevator pitch, right? Who was that? Somebody. All right. So something along those lines, I would take his elevator pitch, I would chop it in half at least, and would essentially reach out and say, hey, you know, this is who I am. I solve these kinds of problems. Maybe you or somebody you know would be interested in talking to you about that. Remember earlier we were talking about working backwards from the job post? And what we came to understand, and maybe I think we mostly agreed on, is that most of the hires that are going to happen in January, February, and March, the hiring managers are already aware of the fact that they're probably going to need to hire somebody, right? All right. So if you were one of those hiring managers and you have an employee at risk, somebody you're looking at terminating, and you have growth opportunities and other kinds of needs, and somebody reached out to you and said, hey, my name is this. I solve these kinds of problems. Perhaps you or somebody you know would be interested in talking to me. What's the likelihood that you might actually engage with them? That's pretty good. In fact, what we found is response rates to job posts and your success with just applying to a job post turns out to be somewhere less than 1%. It's probably closer to 0.1%, which is the reason why you have to apply to so many. What would you guess that if you reached out to 200 people doing something like this, do you think your odds are better than 0.1%? I kind of think that they are. So my suggestion to you is that if you take this kind of approach, you'll find a better job faster than you will just about any other way. Because the other benefit of working this way is that in general, hiring managers want to hire people who do what it takes to get the job done, who are politely aggressive, and by doing this, you actually exhibit the kinds of characteristics that somebody wants to hire, like the lady who I was talking about, literally, who bothered to pick up the phone and call yesterday. What I know is that because I get paid when people get hired, my likelihood of getting paid goes up because I have a politely aggressive person who did what it takes to get into my phone to get me to connect them with my recruiter, who's now going to talk to that person. And unless they're not a fit, I know that there's something about the personality style of that individual that's going to make them likely to get the job and I put them in front of the hiring manager. So there's everything good about reaching out to people like that. Does that make sense? Yes, please.
Okay.
Yeah, two great questions. So my first answer, my first response is to whether or not you're being annoying, right? More or less, is again, for those of you who are hiring managers in the room, I mean, is it not just the hiring manager, but if your approach is to say, hey, I'm looking for a job, do you have a job? You're now annoying. If your approach is to say, hey, I've solved these kinds of problems and maybe I could help you, I would think that that's not quite so annoying. And I understand that when you're the individual who's doing the outreach and you're reaching out to 200 people, it might feel like you're annoying to the guy, but wow, that's a lot. On the receiving end, it's a person who got a message or a phone call from somebody and all they experienced was one time. Here's what I can tell you is, as a recruiter who's really easy to get a hold of, how many times a month do you think that somebody bothers to reach out to me directly and particularly ring my telephone? How often do you think it happens?
Very few.
Yeah.
And they stick out.
Yeah. Maybe twice a month.
Wow.
And what I can tell you is, of the people who reach out to me maybe twice a month, I would guess, I need to track this, I would guess the placement rate of those people is probably 25%, is my guess. Because as soon as they reach out to me, I'm kind of going, okay, at least I got somebody who can communicate. Here we go, right? Let's go, right? And so, and I don't know if it's because the type of people who do that tend to, I don't know what it is, but I would say, my guess is that I've probably got a 20-25% placement rate with people who bother to reach out. So the hiring managers, how many of you as hiring managers have ever had anybody bother to reach out to you in a way kind of like this? How many of you ever had even one? Yeah, all right, cool. And in general, was it annoying to you?
No, it was actually very enlightening hiring. It's his friend, as a matter of fact.
There are two or three kinds of people. There's some managers who will always be annoyed if you contact them, and they may not even listen to messages.
Yeah.
There's some who are so busy that unless they have an immediate need, they're annoyed.
Yeah.
And then there's some who are looking to the future. Those are the people you want to work for, I think.
Yes, those are not only the people you want to work for, but the other thing I can tell you about the ones who get ignored, that get annoyed, they pay so little attention that they don't remember who you were anyway, so even if you come through another channel a week later, they won't remember. So that's part of my answer, and I do understand that it might feel like you're annoying people. It kind of has to do with where your heart's at. If your heart is at finding people who you could really honestly help, then how dare you not reach out to them? You know, shame on you for not reaching out to people and helping them, right? The other part of the question is how often and follow up? Yeah, so let me tell you what I do as a recruiter, right? And I make my living doing this, which is most of the people who I place, most of the jobs that I fill are filled with people that if you ask them, they'd say, wow, 8 weeks ago, I wouldn't look for a job at all. Something crazy happened, and here I am making a career of it, right? If I reach out to them one time each, what happens? Nothing. So I have a campaign that I run. So if you were a target for me, you're going to hear from me in general at least 3 times is what you're going to hear from me. And what I know as a recruiter is that when I send out the first message, I'll get, 20-25% up response rate if I'm targeting it really well on the first message. The second message drops down to about 10%. My third message is the takeaway close. And the takeaway close, it's similar to this one, but it's basically saying, hey, I reached out to you a couple of times, I don't want to be a bother, so this is the last time that I'm going to reach out to you, right? And my response rate is almost as much as the first one, and sometimes the response I get from someone is, hey, I'm so sorry, I've been meaning to get back to you. And so if that happens with a hiring manager, so you reach out to them one time, you don't hear anything, a week later you reach out again, a week later you reach out again with the takeaway post of, hey, I don't really want to be a bother, this is the last time. They may reply and say, hey, I'm so sorry, I've been meaning to get back to you. And that one little teeny tiny moment, you have the upper hand because they apologize. Yeah, about a week. Yeah, about a week is normally what I do. Because if it's longer than a week, I've forgotten about you so much that it's not your second contact, it's your second first contact. Right? So about a week works. Yes, sir.
I try and apply companies where I know someone. So I'm mentioning I used to work with Leo or whatever. Or I also look for companies that are in like the top 100 of best places to work for.
Yeah.
Mentioning just a little tidbit very briefly behind that's advantageous or not.
Yeah, so his question is, mentioning something about the company or some kind of a referral or whatever it is. I think mentioning that you know something about the company tends to be a little bit helpful. Mentioning somebody else that you know in the company can be just as dangerous as it is helpful. You probably ought to check to see whether or not they're in good standing. And if that other person is in good enough standing and knows the person well enough, then have them do a warm introduction. If they don't know them well enough, don't mention them because you don't know in what standing they are. Because they might go, yeah, okay, so you must have a seat. Great, that tells me something about you next. Right? So you're next. Right? You never know. I'm sure that they are. I just don't know whether the hiring managers believe that. So you just don't know. What else? All right. Yes.
So somebody like Susan, for example, with a very specific skill set, if she were to contact all of the medical device and pharmaceutical companies in Austin, and say, I have a specific skill, I specialize in whatever that was, sanitary packaging of whatever that in compliance with the FDA regulations. I just came back to Austin, I wanted you to be aware of who I am and my availability. Is it better if you have a unique skill that you target those places?
I think the more clear what problem you solve, the better off you are. Because if you just approach somebody in general saying, hey, I'll solve all kinds of problems, right? They're not going to be responsive at all. So, yeah, I mean, the more clearly aligned what problems you solve are with the person who you're reaching out to, the better off you are. In fact, specifically when Susan was talking about that, what you do, in my mind, I'm kind of going, all right, I know 3 or 4 or 5 companies. I have no idea where they hire people like that. But, I mean, having something really specific like that, the good news is it narrows the field down very clearly as to the places where they might have those kinds of problems. The bad news is it narrows it down to a very small set at the same time.
Right. But then if you're just a generic project manager.
Generic project manager?
That's
one of the most difficult things to do. Yeah, if you're reaching out and you're talking about project manager, you ought to talk about what do you project manage, right? I mean, software development projects, home construction kinds of things. I mean, project manager is so generic. That essentially just saying, hey, I'm a project manager, is like, yeah, so is my mom, right? And I'm meeting on project managers, I'm just saying that it's an important skill, but project managing what matters a lot, right? Matters a lot. All right. So my whole point here is this is all about getting to the front of the line. That's where all the action happens. My suggestion to you is that by the time a job is posted somewhere, the demand for somebody to be a great fit is really high because they've run out of time. You're in heavy competition with not only, 100 or more people who are also applying for the job, but against the recruiter or somebody who else is doing it. If you go identify the problems you have, identify people who solve those problems, identify the hiring managers who they work with, reach out to the hiring managers and recruiters inside of those organizations, use that as your time. That's what I would do. And in fact, as a recruiter, I make my living doing exactly the opposite. So what I can tell you is, it's a lot of work, but it's what I'd suggest you do with the 7.5 hours a day that once you spend the 30 minutes looking for jobs or responding to some stuff, spend your other 7.5 hours doing this kind of stuff. Yes, sir.
Any of those hiring managers or HR managers that you do actually make contact with, especially by phone, keep them. Because that's how I got my job. The first one didn't work out. I kept watching the company. When they came back, I called them directly. Hey, remember we talked about this? Yeah, this is other. And I'm like, oh, yeah, you should.
Yeah.
And that's how things went.
No question. And one other thing it reminds me is that if you've ever gone so far, let me put it in my terms. So it's not unusual that it gets down to the wire and I have a couple of different candidates who are going in for final interviews, right? They're going in for final interviews. Let's say I have 3 of them. One of them gets hired, right? So what is not all that uncommon, I hate when it does, but it's not all that uncommon, is that, well, the bad news is that within the first few months, it doesn't work out and they get let go, right? Most companies start the search over, strangely enough. They start the search over, which is weird to me, but they do. So my point is, if you ever get to like final rounds of interviews and such, and you figure out somebody else really got the job, then it doesn't hurt to follow up in a month or two and say, hey, I hope things are working out with whoever it was that you hired. Maybe get yourself back into the loop. Or the best case is, I've had people where within the first month or two, they did so well, they were already getting promoted to another position. So it, to your point, once you've made a connection, and particularly if they've ever gotten the final round, really follow up with them about 30 days later and kind of say, hey, I'm just reaching out to you, really enjoyed the conversations you had, and think about these kinds of things. And you never know, the person they hired may not be working out, and they may be doing so well that there's another one. Because that's a really, really warm need to follow up with at that point. Alright, so it's all about getting to the front of the line, and that's how I get to get hired. So, that's my time.
Thank you.